In this installation talk, I will discuss the mechanisms that act as choreographers for human brain activity. Now, these mechanisms are active in every moment of our lives. They coordinate healthy brain activity, and the breakdown of these mechanisms is associated with severe mental illnesses. I will also shed a bit of light on how we could, in future, ameliorate these mechanisms by specific kinds of computer games. And this could open new avenues for creating digital therapeutics for treating brain diseases. But now, think of your muscles when you're carrying out any task, dancing ballet or chopping vegetables for food. These tasks are achieved by contractions of your muscle cells. Now, it's easy to see that underneath any fine-tuned movements, there is an intricate choreography of those muscle cell contractions in different muscles. And this is to say that everything that we do requires a cooperation and collective action of large numbers of muscle cells. And conversely, if these cells were not acting in an organized manner, not a single coherent movement would be possible. The same applies to the brain. Our vision, hearing, and actions and mind, they're all brought about by the activity of billions of cells, or brain cells that are called neurons, in the brain and in other parts of the nervous system. So how we sense and feel and think, and how we plan and act, they're all achieved by pulses of these tiny neurons. And alone they are relatively meaningless or irrelevant, but together they produce everything that we are. So now, just like the muscle cells producing coherent movement, it is the intricate patterns of cooperation and collective action of these brain cells that is required to the production of coherent sensations and thoughts and actions. So my research aims to ask how this cooperation is achieved. What are the actual mechanisms that regulate the activity and communication of the neurons? And my overarching hypothesis is that two separate things are essential here: oscillations and their critical dynamics. So what are oscillations? Oscillations are like human waves in sports stadiums. If we say that raising hands is a signal that an individual human can send, people are more likely to raise their hands and send the signal when their neighbors do so. And when they act this way, the individual humans can create patterns that span the entire stadium of tens of thousands of people. Likewise, neurons are much more likely to be active in up parts of collective waves than in the down parts. And these waves of neuronal activity, they are called brain waves or oscillations. And here we see one of those. So brain waves can regulate the activity of neurons. And if the brain waves can be locked or synchronized between brain areas, they can regulate the communication between these brain areas. And this is to say that the synchronization of brain waves will determine how well the signals of one population can be received by another population elsewhere. This can be measured and experimentally studied by recording electromagnetic fields produced by tiny electric currents in the neurons. These kinds of measurements can be done non-invasively in healthy human subjects with magnetoencephalography and electroencephalography, and they can be done also directly from inside of the brain in patients who are going to epilepsy surgery. The analysis of these signals, however, that's actually quite difficult. So it has taken us years and years of work just to develop the methods that can reveal which kinds of brain waves serve human sensory cognitive functions, where in the brains they are, and how they synchronize in different experimental conditions. Now, this is now possible, and in a series of studies, we have found that human perception, attention, working memory, and actions, they are all dependent on neural communication. And this communication is organized by networks of synchronous oscillations. What about the criticality part? Let's return to the stadium metaphor. So there has to be enough people in the wave, or it cannot be seen at all over the overall hassle. Likewise, the assemblies of brain cells, they must be sufficiently synchronized and large enough for the rest of the brain to hear their signal over all the other things that are going on at the same time. However, if too many neurons are synchronized in too large populations, the brain can flip over a tipping point. And this is what happens in a disease called epilepsy. And it's seen as an epileptic seizure. So there must be a balance between too little and too much synchronization. And now at this balance, the critical dynamics emerge. And in terms of statistical physics, critical brain activity is much like the flight of birds in flocks that continuously are changing shape. And we have found that the synchronization of oscillations in the human brains, they fluctuate exactly this way. And these neuronal fluctuations, they cause similar fluctuations in human behavior. And behaviors like seeing and hearing weak stimuli or reacting to stimuli. So oscillations and critical dynamics together, they link the biology of collective neuronal actions with the psychology of mental phenomena. But now what happens when these mechanisms don't operate well enough? It turns out that many brain diseases show signs of abnormal oscillations, abnormal synchronization, and an unbalance between too little and too much. So my focus has been on depression, or the major depressive disorder, that is globally the leading cause of disability. It incurs a huge societal burden. And we have found that depression is indeed characterized by unbalanced brain dynamics. So in depression, the brain areas for emotions and introspection are too active. They operate too close to the tipping point. And this is likely to underlie rumination, recurrent negative thoughts that are a key symptom of depression. Can this situation be turned around? Is it possible to rebalance synchronization dynamics? We are developing a game, an action computer game, that is targeted to train depression-related brain systems in a manner that could ameliorate the brain dynamics and thereby ameliorate the depression symptoms. So our clinical project is still ongoing, but we have very promising initial results, and we are seeing that in patients who participate to the game intervention, there is a clear suppression of the depression symptoms. These kinds of games and medicine, or digital therapeutics, they would have many advantages. Low cost, they're easy to distribute, there are no side effects that the drugs have, and they can be personalized to individual patients. This leads to a situation where we can use games as medicine, or games as digital therapeutics, to treat different kinds of brain disorders. And this would have many advantages. They have low cost, they're easy to distribute, they don't have side effects like drugs, and they can be easily personalized to individual patients.